Before we get started, I want to encourage you to subscribe to the channel, turn on notifications so that you don't miss any of the content that is released by Go Collect. And if you're interested, head over to Reggie Collects here on YouTube. It's Wednesday, and you know what that means. It's time for the Go Collect weekly speculation recap video. Stay tuned. Reggie here, your friendly neighborhood bodybuilder and comic book collector, and the host of the Go Collect speculation video. And I want to welcome you to another episode. In this episode, we are going to dig into several blog posts that are available on the Go Collect website. They're also linked down in the description. And I actually want to play a little bit of a game with you for this very first blog post. I want to describe this character to you, and I want to see if you can guess who the character actually is. And I want you to put your answer in the comment section. I want to see if anybody can get this one right. So I'll give you a couple of clues. The character is green. He has the ability to self-levitate, the power to inflate himself.
Disgusting blob.
The power to safely have body parts removed.
Ah, shut the front door, man. Oh my gosh.
And then put back together. He can store improbably large objects inside of himself. He has a backup brain that actually will allow him to survive for a few days without his main brain. So I'll wait. And I'll see whether any of you can actually tell me who this character is. If anybody gets it right, I am going to be extremely impressed. The character in question is named Dupe. And Dupe actually made his first appearance in X-Force number 116. And this is a very, very interesting character, to say the least, with a very interesting background. Supposedly, he is an Omega level mutant. I actually have this first appearance, but have not read it. But I now feel compelled to dig in my short boxes to actually find this book so that I can actually read it, because who doesn't love a character that can survive without his main brain for a couple of days? But there is some speculation, some belief that potentially this character could appear in an MCU movie at some point in the future, whenever movies actually come back. Specifically, we are talking about the Guardians of the Galaxy movie. And so if you believe in like long-term speculation or just dig really interesting, creepy heroes, this book is one for you. This next blog post from Matt Tuck is a pretty provocative one. And he asks a question of, would you buy a single page from your Holy Grail? And this is actually a topic that one of my subscribers on Reggie Collects actually asked me just the other day. And the truth of the matter is that I would not. I would not ever buy a single page of a comic. And I'm not opposed to low-grade comics, but I believe that there is a certain threshold that I want for my collection, right? And so one of those criteria is that I don't buy incomplete books. I like complete books even if they are low-grade. And essentially, a single page would be a low-grade or a no-grade depending upon how you look at it and which grading company you actually happen to go with. But never allow my personal preferences to infringe upon what you decide to do. And so if this is something that you're interested in or curious about, you definitely want to take a look at this fantastic blog post from Matt, because in it, he takes a look at some mega comics out there, and he looks at the values and the sales prices associated with some single pages. One of the first pages he looks at actually comes from Action Comics number one, and he points out here that even a single page from this comic can run you over $1,000, and that's even for just a mundane actual page. And he highlights here that 2 years ago, the first page of Action Comics number one sold for over $25,000. And he points out here that earlier this year, page two actually fetched $7,000, while page 27 was just priced at a meager $1,500. So interesting stuff that is actually happening with Action Comics from 1938. Fantastic book. The next book that Matt takes a look at is Detective Comics number 27 from 1939. And this is the first appearance of Batman. And what he points out here is that since last year, the first page from Detective Comics number 27 has actually sold twice. The first time was in June of 2019, and it actually sold for $9,800. And just last month, another first page sold for $13,000, which is a crazy, crazy amount of money for a single page of a comic. But I also know someone that has picked up these books. And so I definitely get the allure to actually own a piece of history, especially if Batman happens to be one of your favorite characters. Matt rounds out the Holy Trinity by talking about Wonder Woman, and specifically her first appearance in All-Star Comics number 8 in 1941. And he points out here that her first appearance actually sold in 2015 at an 8.0 for $200,000. But you could actually pick up a page or two of this book for as little as $103. In fact, page 30 of All-Star Comics actually traded hands for $103. The more expensive pages in recent history have actually gone for about $1,300. He goes on to talk about Batman number one from 1940, etc., etc. So if you have any interest in owning single pages of really expensive comics, you might want to take a look at this blog post. The link to it is down in the description. A lot of people believe that investing in Silver Age comics is a safe way to kind of invest and also potentially to speculate. But the next blogger actually takes a look at some of the biggest declines in Silver Age comics out of the top 250 comics posted to the Go Collect website. The very first book that Ryan talks about in this well-written blog post is Fantastic Four number 3, and he highlights that this book is actually down 125 spots on the sales list. And he goes on to highlight that this might actually be a pretty common trend for some of those early FF books. He points out that Fantastic Four number 2 is down 102 spots, Fantastic Four number 4 is down 59 spots, FF 6 down 31 spots, FF 9 down 31, FF 12 is also down 85 spots on the list. And a lot of these declines have actually been seen in the last month. And he points out here that these declines aren't just COVID related. It's also related to the high unemployment rate and some other things that are going on in the overall economy affecting disposable income. Again, this is a really interesting and well-written blog post that you may want to take a look at. The link to this one is down in the description. One of the things that I like about this next blog post is that it paints a little bit of a realistic picture that not everything is always trending positive as it relates to the comics that people are potentially thinking about picking up. And the blogger, Mike, points out here that he always hears these stories about people that have picked up Incredible Hulk, you know, 181 back in the day, and now they're turning a huge profit on it. Or FF48, how they picked it up many years ago before all of the hype around the MCU, and now they are turning a hefty profit. And he kind of alludes to the fact that people may get caught up in all of the excitement and the positive stories, that they may lose sight of some of those stories that aren't so positive, some of those books that have not performed as well as others have, despite all of the hype that might surround them. And he specifically takes a look at several comics that you may be interested in. The very first one that he looks at is Amazing Spider-Man number 265. And this is the first appearance of the Silver Sable. And there was a lot of excitement as all of the movie rumors exploded around the Silver Sable around 2016. But what he has essentially noted here is that if you are looking at a graded copy of this book at a 9.8 or a 9.6 or a 9.4 for that matter, all three of them have actually seen significant negative returns against FMV. And so again, this is just a sign that just because there's a lot of hype, a lot of excitement around a book does not necessarily mean that it always performs incredibly well. Mike looks at several other books in the course of his blog post, but the one that I really wanted to focus on was God Country. This book by Donnie Cates is fantastic. If you have never read this, treat yourself. It is a 6-part miniseries that is fantastic. It was recommended to me a few weeks ago by one of my subscribers. I read it, and I read all 6 issues in one afternoon because it is that good of a read. And so again, the point of this blog post is that even with all of the excitement and with how good that book is, with all of the it's been optioned talk that has surrounded God Country, this book, like the previous, has not performed as well as many people have expected. Mike points out here that since October of 2018, when this comic was originally optioned, prices actually soared that month to around $230 for a 9.8 graded comic. But he highlights that prices have been falling dramatically. In fact, sales in March of 2020 have actually dipped below the FMV of $130 for a 9.8 graded comic. And again, this is a really great article because it highlights the fact that there are risks associated with some of the speculation that folks may do. And so you definitely want to take some time, do some research, look into the details, and make sure before you spend your hard-earned money. The great debate between cameo appearances and first appearances is one that I don't think will ever end. I have been part of these discussions for years. I've created videos on this topic of what is a cameo appearance and what is a full appearance. Other YouTubers have also done it. And again, I don't think that we will ever reach a consensus on this particular topic because there are people that fall on either side of the line and believe that their position is the right one. But that is neither here nor there. In this next blog post, the blogger actually does a really, really good job of comparing the returns of a cameo appearance for Gambit to the returns associated with his full appearance. And while there could be some debate around what's his true first appearance, these returns are pretty definitive in my opinion. So the blogger Norman takes a look first at the cameo appearance of X-Men Annual number 14. And what he highlights here is that at a 9.8, this book has a positive return of about 26%, and that was at a sales price of $165. But what he points out here is that there are only about 1,900 of these 9.8s on the CGC census. He goes on to point out that a 9.4 sold for about $70, and it has a positive return of 54%, a 9.2, a positive return of 5.4%, and even an 8.0 at $29 has a positive return of 7.4%. Norman goes on to talk about X-Men 266, which is the true first appearance of Gambit. It actually has him on the cover. But what he points out here is that a 9.8 of this book will set you back $385, and it actually has a negative return of 0.01%. But the interesting thing here is that there are over 11,000 copies of X-Men 266 on the CGC census, again, compared to about 1,900 of X-Men Annual number 14. He goes on to point out here that a 9.4 has a positive return of about 3.9%, the 9.2 has a slight positive return, and an 8.0 at $115 actually does have a healthy return at 8.2%. And so regardless of where you fall on the belief around the cameo appearance versus the full appearance, again, one of the things that cannot be disputed is that the returns associated with the cameo are pretty compelling. And so this might be a book or two that you might want to check out. So I would encourage you to head down to the description, click on this blog post, and take a look at it for yourself. To round out this week's recap, we are going to take a look at a few comics featuring female superheroes. And the blogger actually points out in this article that Marvel has done a really good job of setting up its female heroes, but DC might need to make some magic happen. And what he does over the course of this blog post is he identifies several characters that essentially have the potential to do something really special if DC can properly position them to seize the opportunity. The very first character that Mike points out here is Katana, and he says that Katana's first appearance is The Brave and the Bold number 200. And what he points out here is that this isn't just a good book because it is the first appearance of Katana. It's actually a pretty solid book because it contains multiple first appearances of other characters. He highlights here that it's the first appearance of the Outsiders, of Geo-Force, and also Halo. And so this is pretty interesting, especially when you start to look at the returns associated with this particular book. All of them are in negative territory. A 9.8 recently sold for $104. It actually has a negative return of about 32% versus its FMV at $130. A graded 9.6 sold for $71 recently, and it has a negative return of 39% against its FMV of $80. The next character that he talks about is Starfire, and Starfire had her first appearance in DC Comics Presents number 26, and this is another comic that actually has multiple first appearances in addition to Starfire. This is actually the first appearance of Cyborg, Raven, and also the new Teen Titans lineup. But just like the first book, this book also has negative returns at a 9.8, a 9.6, and a 9.4. The 9.8, for example, recently sold for $595, but actually has a negative return of 9.1% against its FMV of $625. He goes on, Mike does, goes on to talk about Jessica Quick, another character that made her first appearance in Justice Society of America number 1. So if you believe in the future, and there are a lot of people that believe that a lot of where, like the MCU, for example, is headed is towards female characters, there may be the potential that DC will go this route as well. But again, DC might need to do some things to ensure that these characters can be successful. But if all of the stars align, there is potentially some opportunity for these books to perform incredibly well. With that said, I would definitely encourage you to take a look at this blog post in its entirety and to figure out whether there's something here for you. All right, so that is going to do it for me. I want to thank you guys for taking the time to watch this recap video. I hope that you enjoyed it. And if you did, I want to encourage you to leave a comment behind so we can mix it up in the comments section. And tune in next week because we get to do this all over again.